Guten Tag and good afternoon, everybody. I'm very delighted and honored to be the sixth journalist in residence at HITS. It's a double honor and pleasure for me because, as I understand it, this is the first time somebody from a developing country has received this award. And in fact, today the theme that I will be talking about will be also addressing this point about how are science or the science priorities and science journalism a little different in developing countries compared to the developed countries. And that's why I chose the title Against the Odds, because when you first look at the set of challenges we face, it looks almost an impossible task to move ahead anywhere, and yet each country has moved ahead at some pace or the other in its own style, but it has reached there. This is the broad outline of my talk. I will first introduce you a bit to Indian science in the global context, India and Indian science in the global context, and then briefly run over overview of the media in India. Then we then come to where does science coverage stand within this overall context of the Indian media. Then the challenges, and of course I would like to always end on a note of hope that there is a way forward. First, India itself. Why India? I mean, at one level, if you look at it, it is still another developing country. Yet, of late, it has been attracting a lot of global attention because within the group of developing countries, there are some Asian countries that are forging ahead. And the fact that this group of Asian countries are moving at a faster economic and technological pace is beginning to receive global attention. And when you're looking at this part of Asia, then India is also part of those countries. For example, it's considered part of BRICS, which is Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa group. And sometimes people take off Russia but still stick to Brazil, India, China, and South Africa and call the group BASICS. And it is part of the Asia 10 countries, and now it is also part of G20. The fact that some group of Asian countries are moving ahead technologically is being increasingly acknowledged even in the US National Science Foundation Science and Engineering Indicators report. In fact, the 2014 report says that the global R&D performance attributable to East and Southeast Asia region, including China, was comparable to that in North America and substantially larger than that of Europe. And both the US and EU experienced substantial declines in the last decade in their shares of global R&D. They were referring to 2001 to 2010 decade. But on the other hand, it is this group of East and Southeast Asian countries, including China, India, Japan, Malaysia, Singapore, South Korea, and Taiwan, which saw an increase in their combined share of the global R&D total. That was up from 25% to 34%. And in a parallel track, the share in published research articles are also increasing. And while the shares for EU and Japan fell from 35% to 31% and from 9 to 6% respectively in this decade, there was a parallel rise in output of research articles in East and Southeast Asia. Of course, China grew the fastest, but other developing countries such as Brazil and India are also there. And how has this happened? If you look at India, at the time of our independence, which was on 15th August 1947, we were a country that had completely missed the Industrial Revolution. And that was a predominant thought in many of the policy makers, that we may have missed the Industrial Revolution because of no choice of us. We were a colony of Britain at that point when the revolution occurred. But now we need to catch on, and we cannot afford to miss the science and technology era. And right from the first Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru, who is the person on the left, to each and every Prime Minister after him, they have been very clear that science and technology will play a very crucial role in India's development. Whether this is always matched by a fantastic increase in funds, that is not the point, but the will is there. Irrespective of how the money stands for whatever constraints, the will and the recognition that science and technology have to be part and parcel of India's development narrative is very much there in policy making. And in fact, the first Prime Minister referred to modern labs and institutes and even big power projects, dams, etc., as the temples of new India, or the temples of modern India. And this is just an example. I mean, there are lots of departments, lots of science programs. So I cannot speak on all of them, but I've chosen a space program as an example, because it's been again winning a lot of recognition in recent times. Now, the picture is of Vikram Sarabhai. He is widely acknowledged as the father of India's space program. He said, we are convinced that if we are to play a meaningful role nationally and in the community of nations, we must be second to none in the application of advanced technologies to the real problems of man and society. He went on to say, the question is not whether India can afford to have a space program. The question is whether India can afford not to have a space program. And he conceptualized the space program as entirely application oriented. Remote sensing satellites will be entirely for land use planning, for urban development, for water resource monitoring, for forest monitoring. I mean, he had a set of applications in mind, just as other satellites would be used for communications broadcasting. The reason I'm mentioning this is this question continues to dog Indians. And as Indian science journalists, we do keep raising this question every time India embarks on a mega science project, or when there is a huge basic science project. We are aware of this point, that is it something that the country can afford to embark in, or should we have other research priorities that are entirely application oriented? But the fact that, having recognized such a problem exists, we moved ahead. And this is just an overview of the various science departments in India. As you can see, all of the research infrastructure is not under one science ministry, and it tends to get distributed under various heads. For example, Department of Atomic Energy and Space are under the Prime Minister's office. If you want to look at medical research, that is with the Ministry of Health. If you're looking at crop research, that's with the Agriculture Ministry. There is research going on in Indian universities, but again, that budget head is not very clear, and they report to the Ministry of Human Resource Development. And under the Ministry of Science, we have three departments: science and technology, biotechnology, and scientific and industrial research. And of course, that means it makes that much more complicated for us science journalists. How do you analyze a science budget? Do you just stick to the science ministry, or do you sit computing individual budget heads? Which ones do you include? Which ones do you exclude? And I mean, these are the kind of questions we sometimes face. But you may sometimes come across differing figures on what is India's science allocation. And this is one of the reasons. It depends who has included what in their mathematical calculations. And just a small note, I'll come back to this later, is that usually the three strategic departments, defense, atomic energy, and space, corner a large chunk of our science budget. Since past 2 years, I think the defense research figures are not out. So the figure I'm giving from the latest budget has only those from atomic energy and space, and together they constituted 62% of our science budget, which also gives you a sense of idea how much lesser the funding is for other topics. And this is just another information from Nature. They did these infographics in a 2014 report on India. You can see that India's investment, if you look at total R&D investment, it is that yellow line at the bottom. It isn't really anything much compared to many of the other countries. But this we are looking at absolute R&D investment. And similarly, if you look at India's spending per researcher, that yellow line in India, it is not as bad as the previous slide, but it is definitely way behind, say, US or Germany or even Brazil, China. It's at 171 compared to 342 in US and 293 in Germany. We are referring to, I think, spending in thousands of US dollars. And India averages at about 4 full-time researchers per 10,000 people in labor force, whereas China has 18 and advanced countries have the average around 80. This is just to give you a snapshot view that these are the kind of funding and human resource constraints that the country faces. That said, if you're looking at, this is also another slide which is looking at domestic expenditure. You can see that in the case of India, in fact, it's been stagnant. At least for the past 10 years, I have been noticing that the investment in science is barely 0.8 to 0.9% of our GDP. And that is quite below the other countries. Other countries have been recording an increase in the percentage of investment in science as a percentage of GDP, whereas in India it has remained more or less stagnant at 0.8. That said, this has not really put the brakes on countries' science. Despite the stagnation, despite the very, very low investments compared to other countries, India's research output has been showing a significant rising trend over the past few years. It's up by 68% in 2009 from 2009 to 13. And in 2013, it produced more research papers than Italy, Canada, Spain, Australia, Korea, etc. Except China, of course, which is way ahead. And India's global share in scientific research publications has increased again. Maybe not a huge increase, but it has been showing a rising trend. And this is again another slide that shows that India is beginning to figure in the world's top 1% of cited articles. Of course, this, as I put it, is in context of our low investments in science. For science journalists, it again poses the question, so what do you report on? Do you report only the positive aspects that we are doing this, we are showing this kind of increase? Do you look at only the negative aspects and say, no, the funding has remained static? How do you evaluate the progress made by the country in a given set of challenges? So we have to keep constantly assessing and evaluating the country's performance. And this is the same point about scientific research publications increasing. And this is one thing. Of late, India has been attracting a lot of attention in specific sectors. One is biotechnology. Both in research and in biotech industry have been in the spotlight globally. In the case of biotechnology, it started with our production of low-cost generic versions of drugs back then when the intellectual property rights laws were a little different in India. And there has been, I know, a lot of international debate over these generic drugs. There are a whole lot of Western institutes and Western pharma companies who call them copycat drugs, and they call the Indian researchers copycat scientists for making drugs through an alternate chemical route which is cheaper and therefore more affordable. There are pros and cons to that argument, which I don't want to get into. But many of the developing countries started relying on Indian generic, low-cost generics as an affordable supply of medicines. And in fact, the international charity Doctors Without Borders, MSF, describes India as the pharmacy of the developing world. And it has also evolved into a global IT hub. It's recognized for its strengths in chemistry. Amongst the various science disciplines, chemistry has emerged one of the very strong sectors in India. And in fact, if we go back to the biotech success story, it is because of its strengths in chemistry that they could find alternate routes to make the same drug. And it is now emerging quite strongly in nanotechnology. Its share in publications has been increasing quite well. There are other specific Indian programs which have begun to attract attention. The space program is one, because there has been a bit of change of thinking since Sarabhai first visualized or conceptualized the space program. At that point, he said that we are very clear, we are not going into exotic missions to Moon or Mars or anywhere, but of late there has been a thinking that, you know, we should try to engage in other forms of science, and we should not deny ourselves this research opportunities just because we are a developing country or don't have enough funds. What we can do is try to evolve an alternate model where we can do the same thing in a very low-cost fashion. The country has an ambitious target of 100 gigawatts of solar energy production by 2021-22, and it's beginning to enter into a lot of mega astronomy projects. It is part of the Square Kilometer Array projects. It is part of the computer analysis team. And it is also going to be the third site for the A-LIGO project. We have a dedicated astronomy satellite, AstroSat, which is sort of a multi-wavelength space observatory. And in fact, much of its, many of these projects, its strengths are its computing power analysis. And that's because, as I said, if you go back to its history, we missed out on the infrastructure because we missed out on the Industrial Revolution. But wherever only human brains and analysis are required, whether it is software or whether it is this computational analysis, which doesn't require so much infrastructure as the human capability to process information or things, and then suddenly India goes ahead there, because there it's no longer dependent on massive infrastructure, which it cannot afford for a variety of reasons. There is also a national supercomputing mission, which aims at 70 high-performance computing facilities with 25 to 30 petaflops range. These are all a snapshot view. I'm not going into details, but again, as I said, when you're reporting on science from India, you know, how do you evaluate or assess these programs, these projects, these ambitious targets? We have to keep analyzing, is it affordable, is it achievable, does it make sense in the context of India's specific problems? And There are journals that are recognizing that the biggest strengths are its elite scientific institutions, a healthy growth in biotechnology sector, and commitment by researchers to address India's social and economic challenges. This is from Nature Index report of 2015, Ascending India. And one characteristic of India, why it has managed to find its way through this set of problems, is it believes in this concept of frugal innovation. And this is a concept that is there in South Africa also, and in Brazil they have different words in their language. In India and Hindi it's called jugad. Jugad is again like the generics. It can be interpreted variously, positively or negatively. It's basically, the philosophy is that if you do not have that much money, if you cannot afford the perfect technological solution, what do? Do you just sit back and say, no, we can't afford it, because we can't afford the most perfect thing, which we know should be in a certain way? Or do you make do? Do you manage with a lower cost, not so perfect solution that will help you tide over your problem and move on, move ahead, you know, not get stuck with your funding constraints or not get stuck with your infrastructure constraints? The flip side to it, of course, is some people might argue it can result in very shoddy outputs if you're not careful how much you are kind of compromising on the less than perfect solution. But India is generally being recognized for this frugal innovation or jugad concept. And its international collaborations are increasing. In fact, Germany is the second largest international science collaborator with India. The red ball on this end is US, which leads, and then the biggest green ball on the other side is in fact Germany. And if you want to read more, there is an article in Nature which I had written about India's fight to become a science superpower, and this kind of puts these various challenges and achievements in context. And this is another slide just to show you that countries like India try to show that sometimes you may not have all the infrastructure, funds, everything in place, but that should not and ought not to stop you. This church, it's a very old church, it's in a fishing village, it's not even in one huge urban city, in one corner in Kerala, which is in southern India. This is where our space program started, because we had Vikram Sarabhai and we had a few other scientists all abuzz with ideas, but there was no infrastructure, maybe very few funds. There was a very kind pastor in that church who was equally interested in science, and he very kindly allowed this group of scientists to sit in some free space and work out the very initial stage sounding rockets or satellite designs. And they sat in that church and worked them out. Now, of course, it's become a space museum, but this is just to show the spirit which kind of carries these developing countries forward, you know. So our space program actually began in this church long before it had an headquarters of its own, which are, of course, there now in Bangalore. And now, of course, we were one of the few countries that could reach the Mars orbit in the very first attempt. Of course, one could argue that Indian space scientists learned through the mistakes made by space agencies in other countries, and therefore they could manage it perfectly. But I mean, it kind of shows the kind of the progress that has been made. But also, as I said, for us as science journalists, we keep constantly questioning at every stage, is this program justified? Is this target achievable? Has the country got its priorities right? And the reason I'm harping again on this topic is these are all things to be very happy and proud about. But this is also the reality of India. We have the highest tuberculosis burden in the world. We account for a quarter of the global TB burden. We continue to have high rates of maternal and infant mortality rates. And 240 million people, Indians, are still without access to electricity. There is still inadequate clean and safe drinking water, and there are inadequate sanitation facilities. We have to constantly remind ourselves that this is also the other India, and how do you now balance the priorities and needs? How do you march forward? How do you solve these problems? And of course, one might argue that is it the scientist's responsibility to go around providing toilets and taps? After all, these are governance issues, and you can't always hold science responsible for some of these governance problems. But from the other point of view, if you're looking at science from a society point of view, as journalists, we keep on asking these questions, you know, where are your research priorities? This is true of all developing countries. We are trying to achieve economic growth, we are trying to reduce poverty, and we are also trying to do that by ensuring environmental sustainability. And David Dixon, he's no more, but he was the former news editor at Nature, and he went on to found Science and Development Network, which I had worked as the South Asia head. It was, in fact, it started as an experiment in the Nature News Desk and then evolved into a separate organization. He described it as a triple helix of development: economic growth, reducing poverty, and ensuring environmental sustainability. And science, technology, and innovation are crucial to it, and research communication is equally important to tell, you know, about where science can help you in this particular pathway. Now I come to an overview of the media in India. This is just to give you an idea that the initial publications began right when we were a colony. The first Bengal Gazette began in 1780, radio broadcasting started in 1927, and TV programs began in a limited way in 1959. Of these three sectors, as things stand now, radio broadcasting is entirely government dominated, unless you look at a few FM channels providing entertainment and music, no science basically. The print and TV programs, TV channels have evolved into major sources of news. This is another thing to be kept in mind. You know, at best of times, we are a very diverse and complex country. We had 22 official languages listed in the constitution. There are many, many more languages that are not listed as official languages. There are hundreds of dialects, so each language can be spoken in a different dialect. And so when you're analyzing science coverage, frankly, it is very, very difficult, and I doubt if there is any analysis that looks at these entire diverse languages to come to a common conclusion. It's much easier to look at English news outlets or channels and a few predominant Indian or the official language, but that's where it stops. And this is just to give you an idea, if you look at the top 10 Indian dailies during 2013 and 14, nearly half of them are regional language dailies. So they're giving a very stiff competition to the English dailies, and they have a wide outreach. This is equally true of the television channels. Each state has its own language, and they have papers and channels broadcasting and publishing in their own medium. This is another interesting trend. Contrary to the global trend of diminishing print publications have been increasing in India. This could be due to a variety of factors, which I will go into later in a later slide. There are people who interpret this point differently. They say, oh, print publications are growing in India, therefore all's well for journalism in India. That may be true, but if we come back to science journalism, I'm not really sure whether the fact that we have an increase in the number of print publications necessarily means we have an increase in science coverage. And Science coverage can be of two types. You get ready-made science articles from international wires and you just put them on the science page, which is very different from in-house science coverage. You have a science correspondent going out and making an effort to write his or her own story, which is a little different. And as of now, there is no data, hard data, to show that the rise in print publications has translated into an increase in science coverage. And one of the reasons why there has been an increase in rise in publications is that India went in for a major economic policy change in the 90s. We changed from a more socialist model economy to a greater privatization. And it's called economic liberalization of India, and it's paved the entry of foreign media corporations. There was a boom in private domestic TV channels. And this kind of spurred this rise in print and TV outlets. In 2000, there was a second development that took place, and that was the advent of internet, and that kind of freed up the entire space. You know, a lot more space was available in the form of websites, in the form of online editions, blogs, etc., which gave space for much more news output. The regional media grew, as I said, and that is to do again with economic liberalization, more private sector people walked in. Though if again you look at it from the point of view of 1.2 to 1.3 billion, the total population, the penetration might still look low. Science coverage in Indian media, so if we now come down, as I said, the science policies were in place in 1960s. The actual infrastructure started building up in 1970s. You can see a somewhat parallel trend in science coverage too. In the 1960s, the Times of India group started a Science Today magazine. It doesn't exist now, of course. And one always acknowledges Surendra Jha. He founded the magazine. But he networked with a lot of scientists who wrote the articles in a popular way, which is not science journalism as we recognize, you know, with newspapers employing reporters to go out and write stories, or television channels, of course, now, or radio channels employing specific science reporters. But Surendra Jha began this whole concept of a science magazine. This gentleman, K.S. Jayaraman, he was in fact a long-standing correspondent for Nature and still writes a lot for Nature and Nature India. He is widely acknowledged as the one who ushered in science journalism as we recognize it today. And in fact, it was another interesting story. He is actually a nuclear physicist by training. He worked at the Bhabha Atomic Research Center. He then went on to become an assistant professor in a university in Canada. And there in some international conference, he saw how there were lots of science journalists from publications in US and Europe who were covering the conference. And it occurred to him, we just don't have anything like that in India. And he left his nuclear physics research and enrolled as a science journalism student in the McGill University. College of Science, Journalism. He came back to India. He knocked on the doors of every major English daily and they said, sorry, we are very, very impressed by your nuclear physics qualifications. We are very impressed by what you're saying, but we've never had this kind of a concept in India before, and I don't think we can have a regular job of a science correspondent. Finally, he went to Press Trust of India, PTI, and they said, fine, we will give you a typewriter for 3 months. You can use our typewriter. If you can prove that the science stories you put out through the PTI wires are published in Indian newspapers, that means they are interested in these kind of stories. we will consider the case. But for 3 months, you get no salary. You just get a typewriter to work on. And he worked like that for 3 months. He proved that there is a space for Indian science stories. And then, of course, PTI employed him as a special correspondent for science. And then he went on to found the PTI Science Service. In fact, this group you see represents some of the science journalists who worked with him, who worked at Science Service. And they're all very active. Most of them are some of the leading science correspondents in India now. The lady on the left went on to become a journalist in residence at HITS. But at that point in life, I was the only one. For 10 years, I was the only one before other young generation of science, women science journalists started coming. And now, of course, the gender representation is very, very different. You find a lot of very bright young women science journalists. The science coverage still is low. And as of now, only one English daily, The Hindu, has a regular science page. Frontline, which belongs to The Hindu group and is a fortnightly magazine, gives considerable coverage to science. Down to Earth is a very interesting and popular magazine on science and environment. It's a fortnightly. In this case, it's not a regular newspaper kind of a group. It is supported by a very well-known Delhi NGO called Center for Science and Environment, CSC. And therefore, it manages to survive because it is part and parcel of CSC. And otherwise, if you look at most of the newspapers, most editors are reluctant to put science and technology on the front page, any page, in fact, sometimes. And they think it's a soft topic, or they want to know what is its relevance to everyday life. And therefore, many exciting developments, a science correspondent has a tough time trying to explain to the editor why they think it is an important way forward in science and ought to be reported on. And political reporting is considered not only important, but if you start as a science correspondent, there is that much you can go. You can, from a salary grade point of view, become a science editor. But if you're part of a bigger news organization, then that's where your path stops. The chief of bureau and the editors and all are invariably not science editors, they're the political editors. So some people don't see that as a place where you can go to the highest in your journalism career. And there have been different studies that have estimated the coverage of science from 1 to 3%. Most of them looked at English and they looked at Hindi, which is the national language, and try to compare the percentages. And as possibly it's a point even across Europe and elsewhere, science gets covered only when it has ramifications at the national or global level. This is a problem for us because if you want to sustain science coverage, there has to be a constant interaction, A, between the scientist and the science journalist. And B, there has to be a constant, publication of science news. And then there is this continuation. Whereas if you are doing something in an ad hoc manner, if there is something, a satellite was launched, therefore that will be published, and then there is absolute silence. Something is informed on genetic crops, and then that is published, and then there is an absolute silence on the science front. It doesn't help either the community of scientists or the science journalists, to kind of have a constant output of science stories. And in the context of science journalism in developing countries, I had mentioned this earlier, we have to keep trying to address these conflicting priorities, see the links between science and public policy issues. How is science going to impact society? What is its relevance to society? And how do you deal with these contentious technologies? and place them in the context of developing countries' priorities. And does it mean that we should always only focus on application-oriented science? Just like scientists are interested in curiosity-driven science, even as science journalists, we are very much often interested in other aspects of science. And how do you balance the coverage? How do you convince the editor that some of the basic science research is also very useful, though you can't immediately demonstrate an application? And how do you assess research priorities? This is, you know, on mega projects, this especially came about in a group of science journalists. We were looking at the Square Kilometer Array Pathfinder project in Australia. The science journalists, I think from Australia, were looking at the Pathfinder project as the Pathfinder and what is its significance and contribution to the eventual SKA. And then a journalist from South Africa mentioned how the science journalist will first grill and ask the scientists how is it relevant to South Africa's priorities. In the case of South Africa, they had to show that it will improve vastly the mathematics capabilities of South African science students, and it will build the mathematics capacities until they could show the linkages. It was difficult to get the funding and convince science journalists. And these are the kind of questions we keep asking even in India, you know. How is the funding when there is scarce, when there are scarce funds, when there are all these other problems of TB, etc.? How do you, you know, how do you justify funding, for example, for going to the Mars? And now I come to the point about challenges that we face in addition to the thematic challenges that we face. According to me, they are at three levels. One is infrastructural, one is organizational, and one is the general communication bottlenecks that exist all over the world. Under infrastructural, I would put in the fact that we have very few, I think barely six universities right now offering science journalism as an optional course in the mass communication curriculum. So it begins there, you know. If your university may offer a mass comm course, but there will be no science journalism component in it, how will the young emerging journalists be primed onto this concept of science journalism? There are no finishing schools that train youngsters to improve their skills. There is no forum for constant interaction between scientists and science journalists, which helps build a rapport and trust. There are no mentoring programs. So it so happened that whether it was the case of some of the other science journalists or me, we were mentored by Dr. Jayaraman. But then there are no such mentors for the younger lot, you know, who can be kind of guided on how to improve their science journalism skills. And we do not have these kind of new sellers that tell you what are the research publications coming out of institutes or universities. We have to just go on hunting. It's like hunting for a needle in a haystack. We sit going through all the research papers, through Scopus, through Wiley and all, and hunting, figuring out for us is where are the papers from India. It's not the other way around. They are not telling us what's emerging from Indian institutes or universities. We are sitting and hunting out and catching hold of the scientists. At the organizational level, now assuming there has been this young journalist who was lucky enough to be in a university that offered an optional course in science journalism, even so, there are very few media outlets that will give you a proper employment as a full-time science correspondent. I had mentioned a bit of it, how there are no science supplements. And there is rarely a full-fledged science desk or division. And if a media organization doesn't have a science editor, then who will guide that young science journalist, even assuming he or she gets a an appointment, there is nobody to guide them. And they have an often junior role. Again, I mentioned there are also career. There is that much you can progress, and then you can't progress beyond that. And there is a dominance on health and environment reporting. And of course, if you are reporting on science in the regional languages, there are no terms to express scientific concepts, which means that English becomes the default language. The English term is just written in the Indian alphabet, with the Indian alphabets. But then you need to explain what the term means. And again, if there is nobody really experienced or senior in the news organization, you don't have a science desk, who will explain to the Hindi or the Tamil or the Marathi or some other Bengali journalist, what does this English term written in that respective alphabet mean? And therefore, the whole they face these challenges in reporting on science, and the translation is really an issue. These communication bottlenecks, of course, exist not just in India, but I guess in a lot of countries. The scientists, as I said, rarely get in touch with journalists, and scientists often think they should carry out only high quality research, and we are not here to advertise our research, we are not here to promote our research, and therefore they would like to believe they are a little distant from all these science journalists who are asking them for information. There are other, most of the research in India is public funded, which means there are a set of government rules, and some institutes take those government rules a little too seriously. And a scientist has to seek the permission of the institute director before he or she can speak to the science journalist. So if we go back to this science journalist who went and hunted through all the research papers, found an interesting paper, noted down the email or telephone number, contacted the scientist, after all this effort, the scientist will say, no, but we need the permission of the director. And then he will write a formal letter or email and wait for the permission to come. And you know, there is something called a timeliness of news. It doesn't happen all the time. And there are certain rapport, as I said, once the scientist gets to know a science journalist, they speak. Sometimes they find their way of bypassing, but not all institutes do. The elite institutes here, for example, the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore or National Center for Biological Sciences in Bangalore, the Indian Institutes of Technology, they don't take this rule very seriously and are more open to interacting with journalists. But there are others that go through this formal route. And we do not have these kind of news alerts, and therefore, or they might put out a newsletter which comes much later after the publication has been out, and that doesn't serve our purpose. We need the publication right when it's out, and then we need to first understand what the research is about, and then we need to talk to the scientists for further simplification. Then we need to write our story. And if you say, oh, we will wait till our newsletter comes out a month later to tell you what research was put out, the whole news value is gone. And there are other, like I said, there are these strategic departments that completely have a very different policy. Atomic energy, for example, will not immediately, the institutes will not immediately talk to a journalist or a science journalist. And but when something like Fukushima happens, then suddenly they hold a press conference and they want to tell you, oh, but we don't have that kind of a reactor here, our reactors are very safe. Oh, no, you guys have gone into an alarmist mode, you don't understand how a nuclear reactor operates. There is this whole slideshow then showing how a nuclear reactor operates, but we do not want these one-time events. We want a constant interaction between the department and science journalists, and often that is lacking. I would still like to end on a positive note, that it doesn't mean that it is a very bleak scenario. We are still managing to find a way through. One reason has been the growth in internet use, and that has really risen spectacularly in India, which means it's opened up the space for communication. And some scientists, the younger generation scientists especially, I notice, have taken to blogging, have taken to social media like Twitter. And some of the key department heads are also now putting out information on Twitter and Facebook pages, and there is some scope for interaction through these media, and that has eased some of these communication bottlenecks. For example, the Secretary of the Department of Science and Technology, which is the key funding agency in India, and the Secretary of Department of Biotechnology are out there on Twitter, and we get a lot of useful, you know, we just follow them and get a hang of new publications or new programs that are out. This is one thing, and some of these institutes like Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, the National Center for Biological Sciences also in Bangalore, they are having a very young, enthusiastic team who have started some sort of a media news service. And in fact, it started as Gubi Labs in a suburb of Bangalore outside, but now it's evolved into a science media center for IISc and NCBS. They put out weekly updates on research emerging from these institutes. It was a group of bright youngsters. In fact, one of them worked with me at SciDev, and I'm very happy to see these youngsters recognizing the need for this kind of research news outlets. And though it's limited to two or three institutes, but at least it's an initiative that they have taken. ISERS are Indian Institutes for Science Education and Research. These are new institutes that are coming up in India, barely 10 years old. They're doing very good work, figuring in those high citation journals that I mentioned earlier. And here they have younger faculty and institute directors, and they are interacting nicely with the science journalists. That is another positive, I think, a sign that some of the younger generation of scientists are much more open to communicating with science journalists. And there is a wing under Department of Science and Technology called Vigyan Prasar. Vigyan in Hindi means science, Prasar means broadcasting. And they started a science wire service. Of course, one might argue it's under government control, but at least it's an effort again trying to update on Indian science news. So at this point, I will kind of end the presentation, because I wanted to give a snapshot of how Indian science has evolved and how Indian science journalism, not science communication, because that involves a lot more other activities like science centers, science museums, science popularization, which is not really my field, but how has science journalism evolved? What are the challenges that we as science journalists face, especially when we are reporting on science in developing countries? And I think at this point I'll pause and take questions, and if there's further information, then I will add on to it. Thank you.